doesn't look like to be sinus, and no one will agree that this is sinus. And you have one sinus beat, this is second part of a ECG, and again you have a non-sustained or you can say couplets or quadruplets of ventricular beats. So let us see how to go about this. And the first thing is, whenever you see such ECGs in a dilated cardiomyopathy patients or any heart failure patients, you need to look at the things which are caused, any other clue you can get from the ECG that is causing these VT episodes. So first of all, I want to look at this beat, that is a sinus beat, and try to see what is happening to the T wave and ST segment and a QT interval here, although not very clear. But the ST segment appears and the T wave also appears a little flat, which is a little unusual. T will not be so flat usually. It can happen. But in these cases, we need to look for any electrolyte abnormalities, because this is already put for a primary prevention, unlikely that this patient does a VT previously. Okay, that's the first part. Coming to the second part of the ECG, where what you need to learn from this ECG now. So this is for sure, anyone has any doubt on this, that it's a SVT? I don't think anyone has, looking at that. So we'll try to analyze this. So you have got, this is a PPC or a non-sustained VT beat. In the V1, it is negative. In the V2, it becomes positive negative. Again, it becomes negative. So this is called as a something called as a reverse pattern break. So you remember this reverse pattern break, you may get such ECG in your exams. So where you see this is a little very classical ECG. And then you see up to V6, it is negative. And this happens in something called as a crux VT. So the pattern break happens in a summit VT, reverse pattern break happens in a crux VT or a VPCs. And then 2-3 AVF is negative, which says that it's coming from the inferior surface. One is positive, AVL is positive, and the AVR is negative. And one more thing which you have to learn here is, you have something called as AVR and AVL discordance. It's a little too much, but I'll just discuss that also for a minute. So AVR is negative here, AVL is positive. So this discordance, if it happens, usually this VPCs or a VT comes from the septum, usually the basal septal regions. But looking at the QRS, it appears to be the crux. Crux is also part of epicardial septal region. So it's likely from the crux. We found it from the site of origin or a site of exit. So this part of the ECG. And next thing is, then never neglect whenever you see this sinus beat ECGs. It's always 73 years. It doesn't matter much. But if you see this, what you can see in a sinus beat is the low voltage complexes. This we should never neglect, because this can happen in certain conditions in the heart, usually in case of the amyloidosis. If it is an young, you need to recognize, and there is a TTR amyloid, there is a good treatment nowadays. If the amyloid progresses, we don't have a treatment already there in the end stage like restrictive cardiomyopathy, but if we can recognize them, that's very good. So we discussed this part of the ECG. Any questions you need, keep posting. I will go to some basic things for you. So the VT, ventricular tachycardia, what you call is as which lasts for more than 30 seconds. Non-sustained VT is the which one lasts less than 30 seconds, and incessant VT. These terminologies you should be familiar. Continuous sustained VT during several hours of the day, which recurs promptly despite repeated interventions to break it. And one more is a ventricular tachycardia storm. This is defined as more than 3 episodes of sustained ventricular tachycardia within 24 hours, or more than 3 ICD shocks within 24 hours. Okay. And then coming to, why should we worry about this ECG? Already this patient has a ICD, but look at this, he already has dizziness and uncomfortable feeling sensation. That's not the only thing, but these patients can go into heart failure. LV function can further come down because of the tachycardiomyopathy. So we need to treat these as well. And then dizziness already patient has, and the brief LOC they can have. But dizziness sometimes would be too much bothering to these patients. And then as a baseline, we need to evaluate all these patients for the electrolytes and thyroid status, especially if they're on amiodarone. Sometimes amiodarone causes a very cumbersome problem. The thyrotoxicosis is very difficult to treat. That we need to keep in mind always. And one more very, very important thing is that before putting ICD, especially to the non-ischemic cardiomyopathies, it's better to get a cardiac MRI done. It is helpful for the later in case they develop a VT like this. If they have a defined area of LGE, that will help for us to localize that this VT is likely to come from this site, and it will help for further ablation. You remember, any patient, if you are putting for a primary prevention or a secondary prevention, ICD, please get an MRI done. Although nowadays MRI can be done even with the ICDs in place, they're MRI compatible, but the problem is that it gives a lot of artifacts which MRI cannot be interpreted. So that's very important. And the second thing, how do we manage this? The most important thing, proven treatment till now for any of the heart failure patients is to prevent mortality is the beta blockers. That's very important. And then the second is ACE inhibitors, ARBs or the ARNIs. So you optimize those medications. That's very important. And then coming to now, as readily mexalatin is available in India, that can be used in your patients, the next choice would be sotalol and then amiodarone. But before starting sotalol, you should make sure that electrolytes are all right and the QT is all right. So if all these treatments fail, then what we have to do is we need to take these patients for catheter ablation because it improves their quality of life significantly. Okay, so any questions? Anyone can open the mic one by one. If you have questions, you can ask.
Good morning, sir. Palak here.
Hi, Palak.
So in this case, like when we are discussing the ECG and the type of VT, are we not going to comment on the type, whether it is an LBB type or an RBB type?
Yes, I told you V1 is negative. This is a left bundle branch block morphology VT. And then usually these come from the right ventricle if it is a left bundle, but that cannot be defined very exactly. But look at its narrowness, it's quite narrow. Likely it is arising from the septal side. So look at V1 is negative, V2 suddenly becomes positive negative. So that I told you that this is called as a reverse pattern break, which is very classical from the crux or in that region up to the adjacent septum.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, anything?
Anybody had some questions? So if there are no questions, I think we really appreciate you for taking such a complex ECG discussion. I don't know how many understood, I don't know, but the discussion is very good. Probably they should understand this point actually.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you. So next week you are going to come with basic CC.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
EP.
Okay. EP. Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Pediatric cardiology fellows are there, students? Pediatric cardiology students?
Sandeep, yes.
Sandeep.
Good evening,
Sandeep,
good evening,
please,
sir.
Identify, where are you from, Sandeep?
I am from Triple M Hospital, sir, Chennai.
Okay, please go ahead with this, Sandeep.
Yes, sir. 6-year-old female diagnosed to have large malignant perimembranous vasculitis.
6-year-old girl, okay.
X-ray showing X-ray PA view, situs solitus levocardia, cardiomegaly CTR of around 60%. There is MPA enlargement is there, and there is plethora is there, multiple end-on vessels are seen. Right atrial enlargement is also there. Two-lead DCG, normal paper speed with normal limb and chest lead standardization, sinus rhythm, heart rate of around 100 per minute with left axis deviation minus 15 degree with right atrial enlargement and normal PR interval, normal QRS duration, normal QT interval, and there is RVH on the ECG.
What is the unit for RVH?
V1, R waves are taller than 7 millimeters, and the transition is appearing at around V6.
So what about V3 and V4? Can you read V3, V4? Those are called as mid precardial leads.
There is a tall equiphasic.
Especially if you see V4, what is happening in V4?
Both R and S waves are very tall R waves or deep S waves, like Katz Wessel phenomenon, sir. But
so when do you call cardioversion phenomenon?
When R plus S is more than 45 mm in mid precardial leads.
Okay. Originally it used to be 60, but now it is 45. Okay. So you can count this and this. So what about V6?
V6, there is that R waves are not very not tall. You know, for
other than R waves are not tall, presence of S waves is worrying.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, sir.
R waves can be that height also. That's not the important point. R by S ratio or the presence of S waves in V6 in a 6-year-old girl suggestive of that there is right ventricular hypertrophy. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Please read.
Coming to the oximetry data, oxygen hemoglobin was 13 and VO2 was 174.2 was taken. Then SVC saturation is 69, IVC 72, mixed venous was taken as 70, RV was 75. There is a step up of 5% at the ventricular level. And from RV to PA, there is no significant step up. Pulmonary vein is 98% assumed.
You take a step up from RV to PA or you take a step up from mixed venous to PA?
Mixed venous to PA, we can take, sir. That is a significant.
Not you can take. You always try to calculate the distal chambers to the basic mixed venous from right atrial level onwards. Okay, fine.
So a significant step up is there. And at the step up is there, and step down also significant there on the left side. 8% step down is there. And
we don't have LA saturation, but the PV saturation is assumed. It is not really true PV saturation. So that indicates whether the child is actually hyperventilated, which we don't know.
Yes, sir.
So baseline data 6 years. It's very unlikely in a non-Down syndrome hyperventilation. So if you give proper sedation, that is reasonably good to ventilation will be there. So you have to consider that there is a baseline. There is no FVA saturation actually, only LV saturation.
Aortic SNART saturation is there, so 91%. That is
approximately. I'm not seeing that. Where?
Above keep it, sir.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. So we'll take this as an important aspect. Fine. Next.
So baseline hypoxemia is there. QP is calculated 4.6, QS is 4.2, QP is calculated almost 1. Mm-hmm. So baseline there is desaturation with significant this bidirectional shunt is at ventricle level. Then on oxygen, the big venous is 82. And there is a significant step up of 13% up to the PA level, and there is no step down on the left side. And QPQS has increased to 2.1.
So you can see the PVO2 levels of 423. They must have calculated. How do you calculate the shunt in the presence of oxygen study? When you give oxygen, how do you calculate? Do you calculate dissolved oxygen?
Yes, sir. We have to include the dissolved oxygen. Sir.
So.
In the denominator, we have to add a 0.03 into the PO2 level.
Okay, read this entire thing now.
QPQS slide, that one, same slide, saturation slide is there.
What is baseline and what is
on oxygen? Yes, baseline, there is hypoxemia is there, sir, with significant this bidirectional shunt, but more of there is step down on the left side. On giving oxygen, there is a complete reversal with more of left to right shunt, and the QPQS shunt also is increasing.
Okay, there is a significant step up in PA as soon as you give the oxygen, and step down whatever the right to left shunt disappear. And when you calculate the dissolved oxygen, you have a QPQS net of 2.1:1. Yes. So please read this hemodynamic data.
Pressure. Yes, in the room air, RA pressure is normal. There's elevated RV systolic pressure with normal RV EDP. Pulmonary artery, there is severe pulmonary hypertension. Compared to the aortic, is almost same. Pulmonary and aortic pressure is almost similar. And
so you can see the mean PA pressure 90/56, mean of 72, ascending at 88/65, and mean 77. There is a diastolic pressure difference of around 9 mm here. Okay, next.
Next, baseline PVRI is 13.9. It is more than
8. You read oxygen. On oxygen, what happened to the pressures?
Yes, sir. On oxygen, RA pressure is normal. RV pressure, there is no change from the baseline. And PA pressure also, there is no significant drop. It's almost same. And pulmonary capillary wedge mean was 10, which is normal. There is significant pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension based on the diastolic pulmonary gradient and transpulmonary gradient. And LV pressure and aortic pressure is not much difference from the baseline values.
So on oxygen, you can see PA pressure more or less same, 92/50 and mean of 70. And there is a diastolic pressure difference of around 14 millimeters here. So what is now PVR by SVR ratio?
In basal, it is 0.8 and on oxygen, it is 0.4. Sir.
So I am going to ask everyone, what is the plan based on this particular hemodynamic data? So a child, 6-year-old child with a large perimembranous VST, malaligned VST, and we did the baseline study, on oxygen study. The baseline X-ray showed that there is a mild cardiomegaly, pulmonary artery dilatation, plethora is still persistent. Whereas ECG showed that mid precardial complexes are increased. However, V6 showed that there is a presence of SVO suggestive of right ventricular dominance, right ventricular hypertrophy is there. And there is some QRS axis deviation, left axis deviation, probably suggestive of inlet extension may be there. Whereas oxygen data is showing you have a QPQS, which is the baseline not there, which is 2:1 after oxygenation. And PVR by SVR ratio dropped significantly to 0.8 to 0.4. And absolute values came from 13-7. So how many would like to do clear-cut surgery? How many would like to do surgery with the fenestration? How many would like to do give sildenafil or bosentan both for some time and recatheterization? How many will give only medical follow-up? Let us keep the child on medical follow-up. When child becomes symptomatic, then we'll give pulmonary vasodilator therapy. So Sandeep, you please tell one of these and why you tell.
I would like to give sildenafil, bosentan and recatheterize later, sir.
So what is your idea doing cardiac catheterization later on?
To reevaluate, like currently the patient is inoperable, sir.
Huh.
So later on to reevaluate that if there is any improvement.
So what is your strongest point to tell that the patient is not suitable for operation and medical follow-up? What is your strongest point? Because on oxygen, the shunt is 2:1.
PVR, basal PVR is more than 10, sir.
Basal PVR is more than?
10. It is 13.9. More than 8.
Mm-hmm.
And the PA, there is a...
Oxygen data. What are the data which is not favorable even after oxygen? You tell me one data. After giving oxygen also, I am not convinced. I am absolutely agreeing with everybody that baseline data is not operable at all. If you see the PA pressure and iatric pressure, if you see the PVR and SVR ratio, PVR by SVR ratio more than 0.8 and the PVR absolute value is 13.9. PA pressures are systemic and QPQS is virtually zero. So baseline absolutely not suitable. Whereas oxygen, what are your findings suggest that she is not suitable for operation?
On oxygen, sir, PA pressure, diastolic pressure has not, there is no significant fall in the diastolic pressure.
Number one point is PA diastolic pressure, there is no significant fall. That's a very, very important point here. Very good. Second?
The mean pressure also is, there is no significant fall in the PA mean pressure.
The PA mean also not fallen.
Yes.
Okay. Sir. What about the wedge pressures?
The wedge pressure should increase, but it has stayed normal, sir.
Wedge pressures are more or less same. What happened to the PVR?
It is more than 6.
More than 6 PVR. And PVR by SVR also more than 0.25. 0.4. 0.4 is high. So even though there is a QPQS which is 2:1, but the important point is your diastolic pressures never drop and you have high PVR. Wedge pressures did not really increase. Suggestive of the shunt is, even though 2:1, it is not sufficient to reduce, or there is no significant fall in PA pressure, PVR in this particular patient. So it is medical follow-up. Now coming to your question about sildenafil and bosentan therapy, lot of people have written that sildenafil and bosentan therapy, there are two issues in this. Number one is, the indications for pulmonary vasodilator therapy is whenever there is a symptomatic patient. If there is a symptomatic patient, there is a indication for pulmonary vasodilator therapy, number one. Number two, recent PVRI data, PVRI association showed that you give sildenafil, bosentan and recatheterize and see that baseline data, if it is falling, then probably you may consider it for surgery with a fenestration. But we have not done yet that those kind of cases in our institute. I am still waiting for those kind of data to come in the future. At this point of time, I feel that pulmonary vasodilator therapy is indicated only when there are symptoms. To reduce the PVR and then making them for operation is probably, it is not that practical, it is more or less theoretical. Okay? All right, then I will just.
Thank you.
If there are any questions related to this, sir, we can discuss.
Sir, this fall in diastolic pressure with oxygen, this rule is pulmonary artery pressure, pulmonary artery diastolic pressure with oxygen, it is applicable for all the patients or only for ESP?
It is post-ICU patients which is important.
Okay, for both the PDA and VST, it is applicable.
AP window, PDA, AVST, and ventricular septal defect.
Okay.
Okay, I think what we will do is tomorrow Dr. Shilpa is going to give a talk, and in between, whenever I get time, not I get time, whenever there are dropouts, probably I am going to cover you. Clinical examination, then VST PS physiology, then pre-trichage patient, then continuous murmur, then Eisenmenger. These are my clinical topics I'm going to talk. So today we'll just rapidly go through that, what are the, how to take a history and symptoms. Being a physician means living more life than your own. So that means whenever the child comes, you have to literally go and ask every aspect of the patient, every possible information from the child. From the family. I'll just, So most of the times we don't listen to the patient. Yeah, as soon as patient comes, what first year postgraduate I see, they will immediately abruptly take out their stethoscope from the apron or bag and go directly auscultate. That's absolutely the last step we do. Even if you don't do also, you will get the diagnosis without the stethoscope. So what is the most important thing is getting a history is going to give you more than 60% of the timings of diagnosis. Remaining physical examination, especially general examination, inspection, palpation will give only the contribution by the auscultation is only less than 20% in the clinical examination. So most of us we'll go to the last 20% and leave the remaining 80%. Please don't do that. First, listen to the patients what they are telling. So I'm going to give you a couple of neonatal examples rapidly in the next 5 to 10 minutes, then we can see. So in fetal life, you have ductus venosus here and foramen ovale and ductus arteriosus. As soon as we ligate the umbilical cord, the first thing what will happen, the SVR will be increased. SVR will be increased and baby takes breathing. So oxygen will go into lungs. Pulmonary vascular dilatation will be there. PVR drops. The duct starts shunting from left to right and starts a constriction from the pulmonary end because the blood will have more PO2 levels. This PO2 increases the facility to smooth muscle constriction so that the duct will start closing. As soon as the more blood flow goes to the lungs, pulmonary venous return will be increased, left atrial filling pressures will be increased, the foramina flap will go and then adhere to the primum so that you will have a transient left-right shunt for some time till it gets closed, then ductus venosus will be closed. So this is the physiology which will happen from the fetal to the transitional circulation. In fetal last third trimester, you have combined ventricular output of 400 to 450 milliliters, where the right ventricle contributes 65%, whereas the left ventricle contributes only 35%. So as soon as the baby is born, the right ventricle contribution is going to come down, and the ventricle which is going to be under tremendous amount of stress is left ventricle. So that is the reason in fetal life, the left-sided heart diseases will not be really manifested that significantly compared to the right side lesions. So left side lesions, even though the critical coartation of aorta interruption and sometimes aortic stenosis sometimes may not be presented in a moderate cases unless it's a severe degree where hemodynamics are going to change in the fetal life. So transitional circulation is going to play a major role. The important aspects: increased SVR, reduced PVR, ductus arteriosus constriction, increased LA pressure leading to the closure of the foramen ovale, all these things will make the congenital heart diseases to present. So first fundamental most congenital heart diseases which present is obstructive TA-PVR, because as soon as the baby born, pulmonary blood flow will be increased, the obstruction is going to be increased significantly because of the pulmonary artery, pulmonary vasculature dilatation, and also more amount of pulmonary blood flow will go immediately after birth. Hyperplastic left heart, coartation, interruption, aortic stenosis, all are the systemic circulation. So as soon as the duct closes, ductus arteriosus closes, there will be tremendous amount of stress on the left ventricle. So they present with shock, pulmonary edema, acidosis. Whereas transposition of great vessel can present immediately after birth to in the first week. So important aspects which I told you in the couple of classes back, the effective pulmonary blood flow and the effective systemic blood flow. Effective pulmonary blood flow, because of the duct will be closed, so amount of deoxygenated blood going to the pulmonary circulation will be reduced. As soon as the foramina restricts, then effective systemic blood flow will be reduced. So they present. Whereas pulmonary atresia, intact septum, pulmonary atresia, VST, they present somewhat little bit later than duct-dependent circulations, because in duct-dependent systemic circulation, the PO2 levels are higher. That's why duct closes very early. Whereas the pulmonary atresia group, PO2 levels are low as such. So duct closes somewhat little bit later than what is expected. So beyond first week, these cases may present theoretically, but you have lot of overlap in all these cases. As soon as PVR starts falling, then post-tracheostomy patient admixture lesions will present somewhat little bit later after second week onwards. Whereas Alcapa, you all know that once the PVR falls down, there will be significant steal. Then they will develop a ventricular dysfunction due to myocardial ischemia. Whereas cardiomyopathies, congenital cardiomyopathies, EFEs, all these present, anywhere after second week, because once the SVR increases, there will be stress on the ventricle and they present it. So these are all various presentations, shock, cyanosis, heart failure, and some of the conditions will be asymptomatic for some time. I will not go through the list. You can read it and prepare yourself in a table column. So first shock presentations, then you can have cyanosis presentations and heart failure presentations based on the congenital type of congenital heart disease. Here you can see that a baby presenting with biventricular dysfunction because of the critical aortic stenosis. Here, why biventricular dysfunction is very important here? Because of the ventricular dysfunction, the ventricular EDP, the neonatal PVR will not be dropped like in a normal physiological manner. So there will be delayed or the PVR will persist because of the post-capillary pulmonary hypertension in these cases. Because of the high PVR, the right ventricle in fetal life exposure to the ductus arteriosus to the descending aorta here, which is directly actually pumping to the pulmonary artery. So it is actually facing the high PVR here, leading to the right ventricular dysfunction. They will have biventricular dysfunction in these kind of cases. So this is a neonate with a shock, a feature suggestive of acidosis, delayed capillary filling, seizures, hypocalcemia is there. So anybody would like to answer the diagnosis here straight away? Chat box, I don't see any diagnosis written by anybody. What is the diagnosis? Straight away you tell the diagnosis. So somebody wrote Dysarge syndrome. I appreciate that. Interrupted aortic arch. Here you can see type B aortic arch interruption. Priya answered very well. And also hyper. And it is the case of Dysarge syndrome. So this is how you actually build up your diagnosis based on the multiple parameters which you take it. So in tertiary setting, when you are talking to the neonatologist, ask them to take the pulse oximeter. You will see normal ascending limb and good descending limb. In case of interruption, coarctation, or any other obstruction, you will see this delayed babies will have hypertension, hyperperfusion, cardiomegaly, acidosis, low urine output, delayed CAP, poor perfusion, mottling of the limbs, all these things and grunting will be there. I will show you some of the examples actually. So this is a baby with cyanosis here and baby is quite stable here. So peaceful cyanosis is an example for the transposition of the great vessel unless until they develop some amount of severe cyanosis, severe hypoxemia or some other obstruction, then only they develop acidosis and acidotic breathing. So here diagnosis is very obvious. You can see the oligemia of the lungs in a ductal dependent pulmonary circulation. This is a case of pulmonary artery shy, intact septum, hypoplastic right heart syndrome. You can see the oligemia. So you get the information again by X-ray. So you have to take into consideration all these aspects. This again, my colleague Dr. Sai Lila spoke on the other day that this is a typical boot-shaped heart in the presence of oligemic lungs suggestive of it is a severe tetralogy of Fallot or pulmonary atresia with the ventricular septal defect. So why in tetralogy of Fallot boot-shaped heart is there, Palak? Can you please tell? Why in tetralogy of Fallot there is a boot-shaped heart?
So because there is first of all there is RV type of apex, sir, because of which there is upliftment of the apex, and simultaneously because there is infundibular and valvar PA, so there is narrowing at the infundibular level, sir. So because of which the pulmonary the pulmonary concavity is not there, sir. That bay is empty. So because of which it gives.
I am not really happy with your answer. See, if you see the right
LV is underfilled. LV is underfilled. Septum will be horizontal. And RV is forming the apex, so that's why it is forming good shape.
So, okay, to some extent. So, there is a dextra position of the iota. Overriding of the iota is there. So, rather than LV is underfilled, the septum becomes somewhat more horizontal. Right ventricle will start pumping into iota rather than into the pulmonary artery. Because of the severe right ventricular outflow tract obstruction, right ventricle is designed to pump into the iota. So, to align into iota, right ventricle is upturned here. So, in the presence of a dextra version, dextra posed iota, a mal aligned VST, so you have this kind of bull shaped arrangement. So, this X-ray, you know that heart failure. So, wall to wall heart, again, we don't need to discuss much about this. So, there are some cases with a heart failure with high wall impulse. This is a classical example of the great vein of Galen malformation where the peripheral AVM leading to the heart failure at birth. So, presentation day one, AV wall regurgitation and obstruction to systemic and pulmonary veins. 1 to 2 weeks, ductal dependent systemic, ductal dependent pulmonary. 4 to 6 weeks, VST, AP window, cyanotic with the reduced pulmonary blood flow. Present at various intervals. So when you are talking about the newborn, you have very, very subtle history. You should take gestational diabetes, SLE, heart block, exposure to teratogens, infection, family history, other sibling history are very important. So why other sibling history? Okay. What are the cardinal symptoms of the cardiology? What are the cardinal symptoms? The cardinal symptoms are, you can clearly see here, dyspnea, fatigue, cyanosis, palpitations, chest pain, and syncope. These are the 6 important symptoms. Whether child has got these symptoms or no symptoms, you have to address in the history while you are presenting the case in the examination. For an example, child coming with the chest pain, you have to ask whether dyspnea is there, fatigue is there, cyanosis is there, palpitations and syncope. And for every case, it's a mandatory to ask all cardinal symptoms of the cardiovascular system. So dyspnea, you all know that. We'll not go very detailed here because you all read now and you are ready to appear for the examination. So I'll just actually make a basic frame to all of you. So, shortness of breath is the subjective sensation of the difficult, labored, uncomfortable breathing. It may occur through increased respiratory muscle work or stimulation of the neuroreceptors throughout the respiratory tract, peripheral and the central chemoreceptors. So, in children now, especially less than 5 years of age group, worldwide agreed to follow the modified ROS classification. This is WHO modified ROS classification, but I feel this is very good for less than 2 years of age group. Older children, it is a little bit difficult, and still you have a borderline zone where you can't apply the NYHA class, which is useful above 7 years of age group. So in this, you can read that class 1, 2, 3, 4, and with various symptomatology here, then you can classify it. But in infants, the most important, somebody's microphone is actually, can you please put it off? So in infants, the symptoms of heart failure are feeding difficulties, respiratory distress, rapid breathing, excessive perspiration. Whereas in older children, exercise intolerance, not able to cope up with the peer group, not able to play along with the peer group, poor growth and fatigue. Couple of years back when I was an examiner, lot of students, they could not answer the mechanisms of heart failure in infants. So it's all given in Moss and Adams why they develop a heart failure much earlier than adults. There are so many mechanisms. Number one is heart rate reserve. As a compensatory phenomena in all the children, the heart rate will be increased. Whereas adult heart rate, average heart rate is 72, they have a lot of reserve to go up to 120 beats per minute. Whereas in infants or neonate, the heart rate is already 120 to 140, the reserve is less. Similarly, your myocardial sarcomere fiber length, which is smaller in neonates and infants. So your Frank Starling mechanism doesn't work in case of neonates and infants. Your endiastolic volume reserve, is less in case of infants and children. So there are so many other mechanisms, but at least I told you 3-4 mechanisms. These are very important to know pathophysiological mechanisms, why heart failure is common in children compared to the adult group. So feeding difficulties means frequency of feeding, volume of each feeds, length of time to finish, time to spend on each breath, dyspnea and excessive perspiration during feeding, all these conditions, all these points are going to tell you that there are feeding difficulties. Most important thing is factor rest cycle. Baby would like to take feeds, takes for some time, goes into sleep, again gets up and again gives. Baby is having type of hunger, air hunger and also real hunger. So here you can see here, this is the resting respiratory distress in a post-vacation patient baby. You can see subcostal retractions and intercostal retractions here. So this is one of the typical left patient due to heart failure. Here you can see the grunting respiration. What is grunting respiration? Anybody? Somebody's microphone is actually causing a lot of disturbance. If they can mute their microphone, I'll be very happy. I put it, Rajesh. Okay, what is grunting? Anybody would like to tell answer? Open your microphone and then tell.
Sir, grunting is an expiratory sound which is produced when the lung tries to generate peak end expiratory pressure, sir.
So grunting is a sound of at the end of the expiration. So it is a physiological means of peep. I agree with that. It is a physiological means of peep. Okay. When do you keep peep? In ventilation.
Sir, when we want the surfactant to be there, like when the alveoli are collapsing.
Cardiac conditions where you would like to keep peep.
Pulmonary edema, sir.
Absolutely very good. Pulmonary edema. Whenever there is a pulmonary edema, you would like to keep a peep. Now you tell me the cardiac conditions where you will get a pulmonary edema.
The TAPVC, obstructive TAPVC.
Obstructive TAPVC, we are fantastic answer.
Sir,
critical aortic stenosis, arch obstruction, ventricular dysfunction, all kappa. So all these conditions will have pulmonary edema because of the post-capillary hypertension, ventricular dysfunction, all these things. So when child is having this kind of congenital heart diseases, grunting is common. So better to rule out the systemic obstructions when baby presents with the grunting. So respiratory distress, unlabored tachypnea is seen commonly in case of congenital heart disease. Whereas grunting with the systemic obstruction, grunting with dyspnea, you may see with the respiratory tract infection and systemic obstruction. So sometimes inspiratory stridor will be there. Inspiratory stridor is due to tracheal obstruction due to vascular rings and dilated pulmonary arteries causing compression on the bronchus or bronchomalacia in case of absent pulmonary wall syndrome. All these conditions can cause you have inspiratory stridor. So easily fatigability refers to a state of being very tired or not able to maintain the expected force. So in case of when do you get fatigue, can you please tell me congenital heart diseases where you get fatigue? You open microphones, one person can open a microphone and tell answers.
Sir, fatigue will be there in those conditions in which there is low cardiac output, sir.
So low cardiac output or reduced cardiac output during exercise.
Okay.
If fatigue is a state where not able to do the normal activities or expected force. Suppose a peer, children are there. I'm sorry. Sujata in a class. Any emergency? So, when a child peer group, they can't participate in, a child cannot participate in along with the others. Babu, you can't name so term like this. Please go outside. So, in a normal resting child, your cardiac output may be maintained very well. Suppose there is a severe aortic stenosis or severe pulmonary stenosis, they can walk, they can do normal activity, but when you ask them to run, participate in the games, then they won't be able to do because of the fixed obstruction, the cardiac output will not be maintained. What is the cardiac output, cardiac index during exercise, heavy exercise? How many times, how much of cardiac output will be increased during strenuous exercise? How many times? Very good. So imagine aortic stenosis or pulmonary stenosis, children, when you ask them to run, they can't do. They will have fatigue. They can't maintain the expected force. That is called as fatigue. So whenever there is an exercise related, not able to do the proper work due to obstructive lesions most of the times, or even ventricular dysfunction, that is going to be most important symptom in this subset of population. A normal cardiac output in an adult is 5 to 5.5 liters. So you know various parameters which are going to make it, increase during exercise is good amount of preload, reduction in afterload, SVR, so that cardiac index stroke volume will be increased and increased contractility. So any problem related to these will cause some kind of reduced cardiac output whenever there is a need, leading to a fatigability or in case of critical conditions. What is the severe definition between severe aortic stenosis and critical aortic stenosis? What is the difference between critical aortic stenosis and severe aortic stenosis?
Area less than 0.6 is critical.
When do you call a critical aortic stenosis or critical pulmonary stenosis?
So whenever there is a decrease in the cardiac output and there is a right to left shunt across the PFO.
No, resting hemodynamics will not be maintained in case of a critical stenosis. Resting. Suppose a child who is having aortic stenosis, he is quite normal at rest. He can walk, he can eat food, he can go to toilet, his heart rate is normal, BP is normal, saturation is normal, ventricular function is normal. Whereas in case of critical aortic stenosis, critical pulmonary stenosis, the resting parameters like resting heart rate will be high, resting blood pressure will not be maintained, resting desaturation may be there, or ventricular dysfunction will be there. Then only you call it as a critical. Okay?
Yes.
So resting cardiac output will be altered in case of critical conditions. So a healthy aortic wall is like this, whereas aortic stenosis is like this. So when during exercise, the fixed obstruction will not make the improve the cardiac index, cardiac output, so that they will have a significant fatigue. Even though there is increased contractility, even though there is a good amount of preload, even though there is a reduction in SVR, that is going to be actually catastrophe in this condition. Similarly, in case of pulmonary stenosis, because of the fixed obstruction, most of these times they can maintain the cardiac output unless it goes to severe, and if they participate in heavy games, then they will observe that there is a fatigability and resting and exercise related cardiac issues will be there. So I will come to those points again. So what is the chest pain? So when do you get chest pain in children? What are the causes? Can anybody would like to tell? What are the causes for chest pain during infancy. What are the causes for chest pain in childhood? Chest pain during infancy, it's a very difficult to diagnose. It's not that possible. They can't tell you the symptom. The meaningful symptom will come only after 7 years of age. Any history given by a child after 7 years of age is validated and you can take. Between 3 years to 7 years, whatever symptom they are telling, it may be mixed. For chest pain, they can tell dyspnea. For dyspnea, they can tell palpitations. So there will be a lot of overlap. Less than 3 years, whatever the symptom is not going to be validated at all. So in an infant, any kind of irritability, fussiness, immediately after feeds, usually suggest it may be angina. It may be Al Kappa. It may be some other problem like a Kawasaki disease or coronary fistula, all those things. Episodic screaming, unexplained cry, pallor, sweating, all these are indirect evidence to suggest that it is a chest pain. Whereas in case of childhood, they can tell chest pain at rest, exertion, or during exercise very, very clearly. Sometimes chest pain may be associated with palpitations. That means during tachycardia. Tachycardia, you all know that diastolic filling pressures will go down. Diastolic period itself is less, the coronary filling pressures are going to be less in time so that they may develop a chest pain during the time of VT, SVT, or whenever there is exercise related SVT. These are all various causes for chest pain, muscular, gastritis, esophageal, pleuritis, myopericarditis, arrhythmias, aortic stenosis, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, regurgitation, valve prolapse, all this. Whereas coronary causes, Al Kappa, anomalous course, that means LAD is arising from the right coronary, traveling between aorta and pulmonary artery. During exercise, the left anterior descending artery can be compressed between aorta and pulmonary artery because during exercise, the vessels will be dilated. So coronary AV fistula during exercise, coronary artery disease, Kawasaki disease, and adults and girls, I have one girl 5 years back came from Goa with a chest pain and we found that there was MI. So anyone can read this? Can you read this, one of you? Maybe I may stop because one emergency is there. After this, I would like to stop it actually. If somebody reads this, I would like to... Hello.
So this is a 12 lead ECG, sir, with the normal standardization of limb leads and chest leads. And with a speed of around 25 millimeter per second, the heart rate is around 100 per minute, sir. Then the P wave morphology appears normal, sir. P wave morphology appears normal. Then the QRS axis is around plus 60, sir. Then the PR interval, is around maybe point, it's around 120 milliseconds, sir. Then the QRS duration appears to be normal. On the other hand, sir, if we see the ST segment, what is the age? Okay, so if we see there is ST segment elevation, which is there, it is seen in lead 3 very prominently. Apart from that, it is also seen in, it's mainly seen in lead.
There is a clear cut ST elevation in L2, L3 and AVF suggestive of inferior wall MI. So this child underwent coronary AV fistula closure sometime back and was an aspirin and she stopped aspirin and developed myocardial infarction due to formation of the thrombus. So what are the reasons for chest pain in aortic stenosis? Any adult postgraduate is there? Anybody?
Sir, shall I tell, sir? Arun.
Arun, please tell quickly.
Sir, one is because of LV hypertrophy causing supply-demand mismatch. Then the elevated LV end diastolic pressure causing increase in LV wall stress. Elevated LV end diastolic pressure causing decrease in coronary perfusion pressure.
Fantastic.
Capillary rarefaction. There is capillary density will be lesser compared to the amount of hypertrophy.
That's the same like a mismatch.
Dementia. And associated coronary artery disease.
Wonderful. Associated coronary artery disease and very rarely myocardial bridges and rarely in calcified aortic wall,
calcium embolization.
So these are all various mechanisms of aortic stenosis, chest pain in aortic stenosis. Other than Arun, anybody would like to take why chest pain in aortic regurgitation? I don't want Arun to answer.
Because of increased LV end diastolic pressure, sir.
So Anand is answering because of increased LV. What is the reason for nocturnal angina, you tell? Nocturnal angina in AR. AR patients, they get angina in the night.
During night time, heart rate decreases, sir, because of which more diastolic duration will be there. So more time for regurgitation. So more quantity of regurgitation, increase in LV and diastolic pressure, and decreased coronary perfusion is the reason for nocturnal angina in AR.
Fantastic. Because of the more diastole, more AR will be there. Diastolic pressures also will become low. At the same time, EDP will be increased. Your net coronary driving pressures will come down so that they develop a nocturnal chest pain. Fantastic answer. What is the reason for chest pain in the mitral valve prolapse? Anand, you can continue.
Because of increased caudal tension, sir. Non-ischemic, non-coronary chest pain.
So what will happen during MVP? The mitral valve will be prolapsed into the LA. So there will be a lot of stress and tension on the caudae and papillary muscles. So that is one of the given mechanism, but we don't know. People say that they are other mechanism. So I'm going to stop here. We'll continue again. We have a lot of things to discuss in future. Thank you very much. I have emergency. That's why I'm fast.
Thank you, sir.